Hey guys, and welcome to another episode of Discussing Comics. I'm Clarence.
I'm Kyle.
And today we're going to be talking about the Netflix show, The Defenders. So Kyle, we've had Jessica Jones, we've had Luke Cage, we've had Daredevil, and we've had Iron Fist. And The Defenders is the coming together of all these characters.
It is the Avengers of the small screen Marvel U.
The Avengers B team?
Yeah, there
maybe C or D, actually, but I won't get into it. So, man, coming off of this fantastic Iron Fist series.
Yeah. Right, okay.
We're going straight into The Defenders.
Right.
And what I noticed immediately is much of the story is closely intertwined with Iron Fist and Daredevil as well.
I agree. So do you think there was some method to their madness in releasing Iron Fist last?
Maybe. That doesn't negate the fact that some of parts of it were really bad or just weren't as fun as the others.
Okay.
I don't know if I said bad. But yeah, it makes sense in the context of them coming on. This being having a lot to do with the hand.
Mm-hmm.
And what we learned is the five fingers of the hand.
Right.
I'm pretty sure it's a comic thing I knew nothing about in the until I saw it in
well,
the
see,
show.
I'm a comic fan, but I've never really been fascinated by the hand. The only thing I've really paid attention to with the hand was the hand's involvement with Psylocke, which is an X-Man, of course. But, you know, other than that, you know, I've never really been, and of course the hand's all, you know, tied into Wolverine's time in Japan, but still, I've never really.
Well, were they really?
Yeah, really.
I don't remember them mentioning that in the movie at all.
Yeah, he is, but they can't mention that because Wolverine is owned by Fox.
Wow.
So yeah, they can't mention it.
Cool. And another thing that like really jumped out at me about this series is that they're about to destroy New York or earthquakes in New York.
Spoilers.
Mm-hmm. Of course, spoilers, yeah. A lot of spoilers.
But we're going to assume that if you're watching this, that you've already seen.
Yeah. So it's that age-old question of where is the A-team when the B-team is doing all this stuff that's causing all these conflicts in the city?
Yeah, they're off in Asgard somewhere doing, you know, Thor things. So who knows?
Yeah, maybe. I get that.
Because for that matter, why would you go back to, and this is a question maybe for another episode, but why would you want to live in New York City if you live in the Marvel Universe?
Good point.
You have the Fantastic, or had the Fantastic Four. You have the X-Men living in Central Park. You have the Avengers, whose mansion gets blown up as many times as the X-Men's mansion gets blown up. You've got, keep going. You've got Spider-Man, keep going. You've got, you know.
Well, I have to ask you this then. What are some of the prominent cities in the Marvel Universe?
New York City.
Is that
literally it? It's you know, it seems like everybody lives either maybe in San Francisco, New York City. There's London. You know, there are people that live in England. There are people that live in, you know, the Savage Land, which is not real. There's people that live in Madripoor, which is where... Actually, I don't know if that's a city or a country. I think it's a city. Well, anyway, that's where the hand is generally out of. So,
okay.
Yeah, I mean, there's other cities, but predominantly everything was New York City.
Ah, so getting back into the Defenders, we get all these interactions.
Mm-hmm.
Luke Cage and Danny Rand.
Okay.
You know the history of the Heroes of Power, whatever. What is your interest in their interaction? How did you feel they pulled it off on the small screen?
I thought they did a very good job. I really did, because I had to go into the mindset a couple of times after that first meeting. I wanted to see Luke and Danny, the best friends that have known each other for years. And I had to go back into the mindset of, this is Luke and this is Danny, who don't even know each other.
Yeah, and to that point, Luke's like, what are you talking about, dude? The hand, you punched the dragon? What? This makes no sense.
But that was a cool point when he sees like, oh, crap, he really wants to talk about this.
Yeah.
So tell me about it.
Yeah,
that was cool.
Yeah, being his friend. So
that was
cool. Like that.
I really like that.
We also had Sigourney Weaver playing a bad guy.
Yeah, Catherine.
Yeah.
And, so.
Yeah, it's pretty. Her character was pretty interesting, a finger of the hand.
Yeah.
Go figure. And I do think it was interesting about how they explain these are five people that left Kung Lan and wanted to pursue the everlasting life part of part.
So here's the interesting thing, and you know, I need to go read up more about this. I know that the hand has always been tied to, you know, ninjas and Japan and everything, and I know that there have been these rulers of the hand, and I know the stick people in the chaste have always fought the hand, and it's always been tied into heavily with Daredevil and Elektra and all that. I'm not quite so sure how tied in it was with Iron Fist.
Interesting.
I would be curious to read up more about what their history is with Iron Fist. Was this conveniently done for the TV show, or was it, you know, taken directly from the comics?
Could have been. I mean, I overall enjoyed it, but I thought there were a lot of clumsy parts in the story of how they kind of, the first time they all bring them together in the building, I forgot the name of the building, and they had their first fight, I thought they felt kind of clumsy. Well,
when they're fighting each other?
No. When Danny Rand goes into the boardroom with Sigourney Weaver's character, I thought they felt very clumsy, like they just all came at the same time.
Yeah.
And a few things like that in the series just feel like it was a convenience to get them all together. It just didn't feel like the story led to that point.
But, you know, sometimes you have to take that out of the equation, that clumsiness, because switching genres real quick. But when I was watching a certain episode of Game of Thrones, when someone and something went somewhere else in the last episode of this, well, second to the last episode of this current season, and I'm thinking, how did you get there so quickly?
Well, we could say that.
You know, that's another thing.
But Game of Thrones has a huge time problem.
Yeah, but you see my point?
Yeah, I see.
Sometimes
what you're
you just have to, I think,
it's
take
convenient.
A little convenience with the timing and.
Yeah, sometimes it's iron, but sometimes not so much. I do get what you're saying. I also felt like I've grown to love the secondary characters more than I thought I would.
Okay.
Of course, like Colleen Wing is my favorite, man. I love her. And also, you know, just seeing those different interactions between each of the secondary characters, okay. I think was kind of cool.
I thought was cool. I was surprised that nobody figured out that Matt Murdock was Daredevil. So, you know, I was like, are you people totally just like clueless? You know, but I get your point, you know.
Hey, man, if Clark can survive, I think Daredevil
with glasses and that's it? Yeah, maybe so. All right, so if you want to know more about what we thought about this particular season, check out episode number 68 of Discussing Who. It's Clarence and I talking more in-depth about this, along with Sergio from the Reality Breach podcast.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, don't forget to subscribe. Thank you for listening, and we'll be back.